biggest challenge is to stay motivated somehow. So we all have to do that every day. How do we stay motivated? Now, oftentimes we have progress in our dreams, and we say, wait, I am making progress. I just need to keep the momentum going. This is what happened last night for me. Just a tremendous experience. So the Holy Spirit said, just say, let there be light, let there be light, let there be light, let there be light. That's the practice. Let there be light, let there be light, let there be light, let there be light. Now, the Holy Spirit didn't explain why is this helpful, why. Just do it. Just do it. Let there be light. Staying motivated. Let there be light. Staying motivated, let there be light. This is the trouble for all of us. Now, it's helpful if we have some sort of deadline that helps our motivation. We certainly have one. July of 2016 is most certainly a deadline where the habits of inattention in this world will at that time be crystallized, globally crystallized. And at that point, it will seem almost like natural to have inattention, have your attention distracted. That will seem just like, this is the way that it is. So that is a very severe problem. And looking at the situation from the 1950s through this time now, it's obvious to see how we're going, the direction we're going in, is to make this inattention seem to be natural. Like as if it were the natural state. And what we're going towards in this world is to reinvest even more heavily in trying to remove blockages, problems, remove problems that don't exist. You see, in the teaching here, which I believe is on track, is to recognize the only problem there is a continuity problem. And that means we have been imagining that there's all these blockages between us and God, so to speak. And we've been trying to find a way to remove all these blockages, where in fact there are no blockages whatsoever. So to realize there have never been any blockages at all is like, it's just too shocking for us. Too shocking for us. Because we say, well, wait a minute, what do I do with my personality and my beliefs and my ambitions and my accomplishments? And I mean, just what do I do with all my momentum? What do I do with my, you know, it's just like, whoa, wait a minute. That's called a continuity problem. The only problem there can possibly be is a continuity problem. That's it. Can't possibly be another problem, because there is no problem with God in reality. We don't have any problem at all. There's nothing separating us whatsoever. Never has been, never will be. So it's only our beliefs in a plausible separation that's the problem. There isn't any real separation at all. So to go from this massive investment in a plausible separation and how to fix this plausible separation to seeing, realizing there's never been any separation, there can never be, I don't need to do anything. This is too much of a shock to the mind, to the spirit. It says, whoa, wait a minute. This is called the continuity problem. Absolutely, it's called the continuity problem. This is the only problem there is. And recognizing this is just invaluable, totally invaluable. So all we have to do is to work on evaporating the continuity problem, not to fix Sim's non-existent problem. And the world is has been reinvesting in a global ideology of fixing problems that don't exist. So this will crystallize in the summer of July of 2016. And it's been going in that direction rapidly, very rapidly. At that point, people will just take this for granted and think that anybody who says otherwise is doesn't exist. Is, you know, not only crazy, but simply doesn't exist at all. They can't be because they're not saying anything at all that's the slightest bit sane or helpful. So you say, well, they must be dead then. They must be dead because they're not functioning, you know, an ideal on our script at all. So what we need to do is flip the script prior to 2:16. Work on flipping the script. Now that's what the dream was about last night. I saw this huge white space vehicle. It was massive, and suddenly it took off, and it went up and started went up really high, and then what it did was it somehow did a loop back over and flipped upside down and came back to a landing. Or you might say it flipped right side up. Maybe it had been sitting in an upside down position, and now it flipped, took off, and flipped right side up and landed. And that's, I was just like, wow. It was just an incredible experience to see that happen. So we need to flip the script into a right side up script. Right now the script is upside down, for sure. So the world is crystallizing this demand, this belief that the upside down script is natural and the only script there is. And this is, and so you don't want to get caught in that, because they'll turn you into, you won't like what you become, what, how your, what your beliefs are. So flip the script. We're working to flip the script here as fast as possible. Of course, it staggers the mind to see this. In that dream, my mind was staggered by what I saw. This massive space vehicle flipping like that, going from upside down to right side up, and then landing. It's like, wow. Truly a staggering experience. But this is the benefit of practicing, is you're able to, as you get used to one staggering experience, you go to the next staggering, and then if that, you go to the next one, you go to the next one. And eventually, you're able to have like this experience of flipping the script, and it's staggering, but it's not too bad. You say, wow, I'm staggered, but it's okay. So this is the experience of success on the path. Let there be light, let there be light, let there be light, let there be light. So what I am here for is to call all those who are willing to practice and keep them motivated, saying, keep working, keep working. That's all I can do. Nobody can do it for you. If you're waiting for some savior figure, you wait in vain, because there have already been plenty of savior figures in the world. If they could save us, they'd just put their hand on our head and you're saved, and that's it. It doesn't work that way, because we have a continuity fear. There's nothing to save us from except a continuity problem. That's it. And that is something that we have to deal with by moving our comfort zone gradually. So nobody can save you. There's no savior figure that is just going to save you. You have to do it through your own practice. This is absolutely key. To rediscover your functioning, use an analogy like piano playing. If you have someone coming in, a virtuoso, and plays the piano beautifully, everyone says, oh, that's great, that's great, that's great. But you don't practice the piano yourself, you're not going to regain your creative functioning. So if you want to use piano playing as an analogy for creative functioning, just an analogy. I'm not saying it is creative functioning. I'm using it as an analogy. But if you practice every day and get better and better and better and better, then one day you are the virtuoso. You are the virtuoso. So everyone has to be the virtuoso. You cannot just think, oh, a virtuoso is going to come in and that's it for you. Oh yeah, Jesus, that's great. Okay. Now you have to get comfortable with your own virtuosity. Comfortable with your own isness. Comfortable with your own, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me to be. Comfortable with your own non-existence. perfect non-existence. Your own comfortable with your own freedom, functional with your own within your own freedom, functional within the oneness, functional, functional, functional. So we're going towards functionality. So I'm only here to encourage those who are willing to practice and are practicing to keep practicing, to do more, keep practicing. And of course those who are not, I strongly suggest they begin. But what the world always does, the upside down, is it says, I'll practice, but first just take care of my problems. I'm not able to practice because of this. This is always the way it is. This is the way in my life. This is nonstop. All I've run into is this. I want to practice, but I can't. Fix my problems for me. I'm not here for that. I'm here to encourage those who are practicing to keep going, to keep doing it. I cannot convince anyone to start practicing, because that actually comes from within them. They're the ones who have to decide that this is what they're going to do, and then they can get encouragement from others. But it's has to come from within. And they have to feel like, you know what, maybe my problems are not going to be solved except through this practicing. As long as we think that our problems are going to be solved by somebody doing something for us, we're not going to practice. We keep thinking that there's some problem, that a blockage, something separating us from God. Not true. Only our continuity fear. So the only practice to do is to evaporate this continuity fear. That's it. Only that will work, because only that will help us realize we don't have any problems. There's never been any problem. Never even existed. Existence, there's never been any existence. Therefore, there can't possibly be any problem whatsoever, except this continuity problem of a belief system. So I'm only encouraging those who are practicing to practice more and to be more consistent and again, the basic problem is people believe there's a problem other than the continuity problem. And therefore they say, well, first I have to get rid of this problem and then I can practice being happy. That never works that way. Never works that way. Just makes matters worse. So you have to say, first I'm going to work on evaporating the continuity fear and make that my primary approach. And let the other go. Don't worry about trying to solve a bunch of problems of the world. In fact, these problems arise because as excuses to avoid practicing. That's why they arise. So it's kind of saying, well, as soon as I acknowledge this excuse, then I'll start practicing. No. You have to recognize this is just an excuse. It's just an excuse to not practice because the continuity fear is so severe. You feel that it's impossible, you'll never be able to do it. And I'm saying, absolutely, you can do it. Because you have to factor in the Holy Spirit, which is a wild card. There's no way you can know how effective the Holy Spirit is. You just have to have faith in that it will help you and be effective eventually. And ultimately, you have no choice. You have to evaporate the continuity fear, because there isn't any problem. Never will be. There isn't any separation. There never will be. So there isn't any separation to fix. There isn't anything to fix. There isn't any problem to solve. And this will always be the case. So you see, as you go on continuing to try to solve problems more and more, what are you doing? You're just keeping alive the severe continuity fear is all you're doing. That's it. Just delaying. Just delaying. Nothing more than simply delaying. And then you still have to go through the continuity problem, evaporate it. So basically you can say you're getting nowhere. Getting absolutely nowhere. So that this coming cycle of the world is people are saying, okay, let's all get nowhere for a long time together. That should be fun. Well, it's not fun. It is not fun at all. So here in California, the excuse to not practice is a very subtle one. It's interesting. It's the day is so incredibly beautiful. You say, oh, I can't practice the day. I've got to enjoy the day. I'm not going to sit here in a dark room practicing or something. Come on, are you kidding me? I mean, today is even better than yesterday. Whereas some places the excuses are very negative, a lot of very negative problems. Here, it's everybody's so happy and healthy and so the day is so beautiful. Why aren't we out, you know, going somewhere, you know, to be around happy, healthy people and, you know, drinking in the sunshine and everything. And so there's a feel like, let's do something. And literally you fritter your life away with excuses. And then claim, well, I couldn't do otherwise. You can't expect me to have done otherwise. Oh, absolutely, you're expected to do otherwise. Because there's no exceptions and no exemptions whatsoever. You either do it or you delay. Either delay or you do it. That's it. Now we know that winter is coming. So we know that this day will slip away and it will change and we think, oh, I gotta drink in this day, you know, for what it is. But still, no excuse. Still have to get in as much practice as possible. Just as in the other days, you must do so. So let there be light, let there be light, let there be light, let there be light. So one might say, this problem we have is the problem is that there is no problem. And we have been imagining that we're causing problems for ourselves to such an extent that we just cannot believe that we don't have any problems. There is no problem whatsoever. We just can't believe it. And that's the continuity problem. And when you accept this, you say, well, what do I do about it? Well, evaporate the continuity problem. That's what we do here. That's what spiritual practice is all about. Gradually get used to this. I heard Ramana Maharshi say a couple days ago, he said, we're devising all these spiritual practices to get rid of a non-existent problem. And it just clicked. They said, that's exactly what we're teaching here. And it's like, wow. Just to hear that was stagger the mind. So again, our problem is that there is no problem. Our problem is there is no problem. And we've been believing that there is a problem for so long that this staggers the mind. No way around it. There's no way around it. We keep thinking that we'll devise some robotic way around it or something. No. This is not robotics. This is mind. This is spirit. It's not some algorithm. This is spirit. Spiritual problem, not an algorithm problem. Our spiritual problem is that there is no spiritual problem. This staggers the mind. Our spiritual problem is that there is no spiritual problem. So we keep dreaming up all these quote-unquote physical problems just so we have problems. Like, okay, we've got to have some problems. We're so frightened of the fact there is no spiritual problem at all. But we keep imagining that we're bodies with all the problem, and imagining problems for the body. Even the body doesn't have any problem. That too is true. As Jesus said, we're imagining the body can get sick and get in age and all this stuff. All imagining. He says none of that is true. Infirmity has to do with this, everything, because there's no existence at all. There is no time-space process and form at all. We're just plausibly believing there is, actually. So when you talk about physical problems, well, you have to go to the root, which is the fear that spirit doesn't have any problem whatsoever. And our spirit's unwillingness to accept this, continuity fear to accept this, so it's projecting this dream of all sorts of problems. So it feels comfortable. Yeah, I've got problems. I have a body. I have a body. That's great. So people think, well, when the body dies, that's fine. No, because we've just been imagining that the body dies, imagining that there's some time-space process form of whatever. And spirit is still totally frightened, very frightened, that it doesn't have any problem whatsoever. So it will continue to imagine that it has problems. It will continue to imagine that it has a body. It will continue to imagine it has the problem of impermanence. It will continue to imagine it has the problem of process and change and all of that, determinism. Just so it can... And it doesn't realize it has a continuity fear. This is the great awakening, is when spirit realizes that it has a continuity fear. Changes the whole landscape entirely. And you just say, wow, wait a minute. I don't need all this other stuff, really. This is just an expression of continuity fear, is all that it is. So you don't have to try and solve the problem of aging and death and all these things, problems. You don't have to work on that at all. You just work on your continuity problem, and that will take care of everything. You simply will not need to project fear, problematicalness. You won't need to project it anymore. That's how the dream turns into a happy dream, as it were, turns to it. And you don't need it anymore. So I don't need imaginary problems anymore. Because I'm willing to accept that a spirit cannot have problems. It's never had any problems. So spirit has never existed. I don't exist. I've never existed. I've never been, I never will be, I'm non-existent. I don't have any existence whatsoever. No existence. Existence means time, space, process, and form. Don't have any existence. Just been imagining it. Initially, in an attempt to change what I am. But after we said, no, can't do that. Now we have this memory, this dream memory, honoring this idea, which has brought up this continuity fear. Because we want so desperately to believe it's plausible that we can change what we are. We wanted to believe that we did create a problem for reality, and we didn't. So all this is clinging to the belief that we created a problem for reality. And looking at reality, we see there's no problem there whatsoever. And then we say, oh, this is too shocking for me. Continuity fear. So recognizing this enables the mind attention to turn to where it needs to be, instead of constantly going in all these different directions of problems, trying to fight off this problem and that problem and this problem. We just say, no, I don't have it. I only have one problem. That's the continuity problem. There's only one problem for everyone. It's exactly the same. We're perfect. And we've been imagining we'd somehow altered or changed that perfection to imperfection. And that never happened. And that staggers our mind to. And yet this is true, so we have to accept truth. Only truth is true, nothing else is true. Only truth is true, nothing else is true. Nothing else is true. See, nothing else is true. The belief in plausible problems is not true. Untruth is never going to be true. Our desire to create problems for ourselves, for reality, doesn't create problems for reality. That's not a problem for reality. It's not. We just simply dream that there's problems, that there aren't any. Our freedom, see, we're free to dream, free to experience anything we want every single moment. So how can there be a problem? That basic functionality never changes. So we can imagine that we have problems this instant, and the next instant we can imagine that we don't have any. We can imagine everything's determinate, and the next moment we can recognize or imagine nothing is determinate. But still, the functioning is perfect freedom in the now, in this moment, without any connection, any process, determinism whatsoever. That never changes. So we can never actually imprison ourselves at all. We can never change our functionality at all, not even in the slightest bit. So the more we hear this, and keep hearing it, the more we are evaporating our continuity fear, for sure. And it's a slow process because it's a very severe fear we have. Because perfection allows for no exceptions or exemptions whatsoever. And we've been basing our whole belief system on exceptions and exemptions. Changes, alterations, imperfections, problems. So basically, our entire belief system has to go. In fact, ultimately, belief itself has to go. There's zero need for belief in reality. Reality doesn't need any belief in reality. Reality simply is, without any exceptions or exemptions ever. Total perfection, total perfect functionality. Without any change or alteration ever. So it's a nice day today, but what kind of day is it if we don't have spiritual intensity in a day like this? It's a day wasted, a flat day. People going to the mall, you know, getting dressed up, shopping. God knows where they get the money to shop, but they shop and go out to a restaurant and laugh and listen to, you know, the raucous music and they think, oh, I had a great day. No, they had a wasted day. So what we're trying to do here is get more depth, get the mind really staggered even more. A day without staggering the mind with spiritual truth is a day wasted. So I'm desperate for more staggering good news. It's difficult to find on the internet, looking, where can I get something that's even more staggering? I desperately need it. Well, that dream of flipping that huge vessel being flipped, flying vessel being flipped, wow. That was staggering. So sometimes our dreams stagger us, oftentimes. Whereas in the day-to-day world, things don't seem to be that staggering. We almost have to really work hard to get some intensity and stagger our mind with spiritual truth. Okay, remember, the staggering of the mind is with spiritual truth, with the good news, not with something else. People keep staggering their minds, or we, spirit, keep staggering itself, mind, with bad stuff, bad news, terrible stuff, scary things. No, what we do here is stagger the mind with good news. This is the spiritual path. Stagger the mind with good news. And it's a carrot and stick. The stick is, if you don't stagger the mind with good news, certainly you're going to end up staggering the mind with bad news. Okay, it's one or the other. And the world will certainly help us with that. All right, constantly. Just you turn on the news, you look at the newspaper, whatever source, is gruesome. What it does, it staggers your mind with bad news, with horrible stuff. Turn on the weather channel. Monster storm about to wreak great destruction, just as you stagger yourself, we stagger ourselves with bad news, because we realize we do have to stagger the mind somehow, but without understanding it's a continuity fear, we then end up staggering with bad news. So the world, you might say, is in the business of staggering our minds with bad news. Always has been. Just look at, read history, just recognize history is staggering with bad news. Incredibly staggering. You got Genghis Khan, descending upon an empire and going from city to city to city. And after that, another, Tamerlane. After that, another, just waves and waves. Constantly, the world is staggering itself with bad news, with horrible news, gruesome news. We'll continue on and on and on. In various ways, unless you flip the script and stagger the mind with good news. Because this is what sets us free. You see, as long as we think there's some problem, we'll keep trying to identify the problem. So we'll keep staggering ourselves with bad news. We say, well, maybe this is the problem. Maybe this plague is what's separating us from happiness. Let's go to work on this or something. Remember, the good news is that there is no problem. So, and that's what we're most frightened of. We're frightened of our perfection. See, as long as we keep working on some problem, we think we don't have to worry about our perfection, right? Because now we say, well, we'll be perfect once we solve this problem. But, oh, there's another one here. Wait a minute, this one has problems over here, and we just keep going. So we never have to face our perfection. The spiritual path begins when we face our perfection for a moment. As Jesus says, the holy instant, you must have a holy instant at some point, and then you realize, oh my gosh, we're perfect. Spirit's perfect. And then that staggers the mind, and you say, wow, how am I going to accept this? Well, continually stagger the mind with good news, bit by bit by bit. Really good news. Not the good news that somebody graduated from school and somebody got a new car. No. Stagger the mind with really great news. Now, this is. I'm looking at this, and there are ways to do this. We have to be careful in certain ways. because we can, you can, it's possible to use techniques to stagger the mind and to help out. But I believe I made a mistake previously by saying, for instance, a great teacher is returning, like Sri Anandamayi Maharaj is coming back. Well, it staggered my mind with great news. And then I went to work on that. But it could very well have been that this is just a technique, you see. Like, hey, what if Jesus were here right now today? And this staggers our mind with great news, right? And so we practice, hey, perfection is will be among us soon, that kind of thing. It's actually an imaginary technique to we imagine what if, and then this helps stagger our mind. Because certainly on the time frame that I was believing in, it didn't happen. And certainly people have been believing that Jesus is coming back since the moment he left. I mean, the apostles thought his return was within a few years. Very soon. Right? So, it may be that this is simply a technique to use. And sometimes in dreams these teachers show up. And it's to stagger our mind with perfection, with great good news. So this technique has been used, for instance, like the saucer cult people and all those. They say, okay, we're the millennialists. We're going to be raptured now in this date, you know, is. And so they really, really work, just, you know, tremendous effort to stagger themselves with great good news and get used to that. That's super helpful. Now, the rapture didn't happen, but they put an enormous good effort, and that enabled their minds to get more and more used to great good news. So it's a fine line between role-playing this good news to get this effect and actually believing in an empirical, you know, that it's actually going to happen. It's a fine line. And if there is something that is actually going to happen, it's also a fine line between, because those who've been role-playing this will say, oh, no, that's just another role-playing thing. So they won't believe in it. If it did happen, it's interesting. Like what I do sometimes is I say, today is the day I'm going to meet the guru for sure. And so I feel like today, I'm at some point in time in the day, somehow I'm going to meet this perfect guru. So I say, okay. So I said, I better get ready. So I really start practicing, you know. Now, I've never met the guru any day, but it's a technique, right? It's a role-playing technique type of thing where you have this anticipation, like, well, maybe I might, you know, this is real possible, I might, so I better, you know, keep working. And you could say, today's the day I'm going to ascend, today's the day the rapture is going to happen, I better be ready. This is just a technique of pressuring yourself for with really, really great news, so the mind is staggered and you keep getting, moving your comfort zone. Whereas those who say, well, hey, if it happens, then it happens. I'm not going to do anything to get ready. If it happens, okay. See, they're missing out. They're missing out on the technique. They're not using their imagination in a positive way. Because if and when it does happen, they won't be ready. They wouldn't have moved their comfort zone in the slightest bit. So people might say, oh, those crazy religious fanatics, the world, they're thinking Jesus is coming back, blah, blah, blah. No, those people are preparing their minds for perfection, actually, is what they're doing. Ultimately, is to realize that there's never been any problem at all. So it's good to have all this plurality of people expecting really great stuff to happen. Good news, good news, good news. As long as you realize, take it primarily, here's the mind. Keep staggering the mind with really great news. But ultimately, even beyond all that, it's even more effective to hear the non-dual type of teaching, transmission. So for me, whether a teacher shows up or not, really, the staggering good news is present, with present, already present. There isn't any problem. I never existed. See, I've never existed. Whether Jesus shows up or not, I've never existed in the first place. I've never been born. I don't exist. I've never existed. The best news at all. And Jesus doesn't need to show up because there is nowhere to show up in, actually. Having never existed, there isn't anywhere of my existence or even where of my non-existence. I neither exist nor do I not exist. Neither existence nor non-existence. So where is there to show up? Must already be here. Yeah. Anyone who said he left doesn't get it. Neither arrived nor left. Always been here. And even here is neither here nor there. Neither here nor not here. Pointing to isness, which is beyond any conceptual ramification possible. So isness has always been isness. Isness has always been isness. It's never been a problem. Never changed, never altered. Nothing has ever happened. As Punjaji says, nothing has ever happened. Nothing has ever happened. So what we do here is we allow ourselves to be staggered by that, instead of just saying, like a parrot saying, oh, okay, I can say nothing has ever happened. Oh, good, I parroted the words. No, we let it sink in. Nothing has ever happened. This is truth. No accomplishment has ever taken place. Never will. No accomplishment will ever take place. Nothing real has ever been threatened. Nothing unreal exists. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. Let there be light. Let there be light. Let there be light. Let there be light. We're flipping the script here. So keep getting used to flipping the script. Keep getting used to flipping the script. The dream last night was this massive flip of the script. Let there be light, let there be light, let there be light, let there be light. Nothing ever happened. No teaching, no teacher, no student. So again, let all this impact and stagger the mind. Don't use any drugs to try to help the staggering. In that case, it's the drugs that stagger the mind, not the spiritual truth, the good news. So, in your practice, get to that point where you feel saturated with this staggering good news, which I've been able to do now in this video. If you're feeling it, sort of let it get into you. Let it get into you. but not to try to break anything. There's nothing to break. What we're afraid of is we'll realize we don't exist. I don't exist. Which is actually great. Who wants to exist? Nobody wants to exist, are you kidding? That's hell. The problem the struggle we do, the mistake we make, is to say, yeah, I exist, but how do I now not, how do I get to non-existence? Right? In other words, how do I get rid of my existence? We don't get rid of it. We realize that we've never existed. It's very different than saying I have existed, but now I don't anymore. That's duality. That's the false path that keeps you in chain, in misery. So, in saying I don't exist, also make sure you add I've never existed. Very important. Because if we don't do that, we say I don't exist, and then we'll say, okay, well, how did I get rid of my existence then? You see, well, so how did I get rid of it? And when we have moments of realization, we go back to dualism and say, okay, great, I experienced I don't exist, that's great, but how did I get rid of my existence? And then you start thinking, then immediately you're trapped again. So when you realize I don't exist, you also say, oh great, I've never existed. It's never been, I've never existed at all. Never will exist. Okay, again, the problem we have, we catch a glimpse of the vision of oneness and we say, well, that's great. How did I get rid of the non-oneness? How did I get rid of the non-oneness? How did I get rid of the separation then? What happened? What got rid of it? Where'd it go? So it's the old story of the rope and the snake. Mistaking a rope to be a snake, and then you see it's a rope and you say, oh, that's great. And it's a rope. And I wonder, how did I get rid of the snake? Where'd it go? This is a classic mistake. And it's this we have to work on. This is the classic mistake that torments us. So always work on, I don't exist. I have never existed. I have never, ever, for even for a moment, existed. It's like saying, never ever for a moment was there any snake there. There is no snake. There is no existence. There's nothing to get rid of. Just a hallucination. So I don't exist, I have never existed. Let there be light, let there be light, let there be light, let there be light. See, there is no teaching, there is no teacher, and there is no student concerning how did I get rid of existence. There is no teaching of that, there is no teacher of that, and there is no student of that. What happens is, the answer is, I just realize I don't need it, I don't need that belief anymore. Where'd it go? I simply don't need it to arise. It's just been perpetually arising like a fountain because my fear has needed that. Now, I'm not so afraid, so the fountain doesn't have to arise like that. It's like a fountain. It's moment by moment arising, right? It's not like there is a fountain. It's a continual stream that is arising, and we label it like, oh, look at that beautiful jet of water, that fountain. But it's continual. If we shut off the power of that fountain, poof, where is it? Gone, see? So it's not gone. There's nothing there. It's just the arising isn't taking place anymore. It just subsided into itself. Like a wave just subsiding into the ocean. It's never separate from it, actually. So arising is never separate from non-arising. Arising is never separate from subsiding, and it's never separate from non-arising. Mistake is to think that they're somehow separate. It's one inherent seamlessness. Arising is never separate from subsiding, is never separate from non-arising. This is Dzogchen basically teaching, Longchenpa teaching, very advanced. I can feel it just like, wow. Arising is not separate from sustaining, is not separate from subsiding, is not separate from non-arising. It's all one. No separation at all. This is a mind staggerer for sure. Very important when you get to deeper levels, don't intellectualize it. That's a defense mechanism. Basically, the feeling is like, uh-oh, this is heavy duty, wow. But say, okay. It's like an incredibly difficult hole in golf. You get to look at it and you just down the mountain like this way, and then over a gorge this way, then up here. You say, you're standing on the tee, you say, oh my God. And then you have to avoid starting to think too much. Trying to be too perfect, say, wait a minute, okay, I've got to place this drive. It's like 10 yards left of this trap, but the hill's tilted this way, and the runoff is going to be this amount. I need to shape it this way, but I don't want to hit it too far, and I need to do this, and then I want to set up my second shot. And you start thinking too much, and then you can't even swing. You just, what you need to do is just say, well, when I get there, I get there. I'm not going to worry about it. I'm just going to just put a good swing on this ball and go find it and do the same. Go find the next one. And eventually we'll get there. That's the way you have to do it. So this is very powerful. You just say, okay, great. We'll just full stop in the wow of this. We won't worry about how it arises, you know, subsequently. So if you put a good swing on the ball and another good swing, another good swing, before you know it, you're there and you finish with the hole and you say, it wasn't too bad. You just cannot overthink it. Which is what golf courses try to do. They try to trick you into overthinking a situation. You have to keep it simple. Just the same way here, we just have to keep it simple. Don't intellectualize it. Spirit has heard this already. I mean, Spirit's got it. It's like, wow. I could feel just my spirit just hit it very hard. Just, wow. I hadn't thought of that before. I hadn't really seen that before. Arising is not separate from sustaining, is not separate from subsiding, is not separate from non-arising. What I mean by don't intellectualize it, don't try to push it too far. It's enough that to see it like this. It's enough to see it for the first time like this. That's enough. When you make the great breakthrough, it's enough that you've seen it like this. Just then manage the success and don't intellectualize. Don't say, wow, I wonder, okay, now how am I going to approach this tomorrow? Or how can I explain this even deeper? Or how can I? No. So you avoid that. Because then you won't get the full experience of how it feels right now to make this initial breakthrough. And then you won't be sure that it's safe to take the next step. So only by allowing this first step to permeate and experience it will you then feel confident in taking the next step. It's the only way. So if you hit a nice good swing, hit a good ball, go find it in a good position, oh, that's great. Now you can feel comfortable to hit another good ball. Whereas if you slice it out of bounds or hit it in some trouble, you're thinking too much. Now you're thinking even more. It's like, wow, now I'm really in worse trouble. And it just compounds. So don't be thinking about your next shot. Don't be thinking about your next shot. That is for sure. The golfers say one shot at a time. This is the discipline. One shot at a time. Don't be thinking about anything but just one shot at a time. It's very important. So we take just one breakthrough at a time here. We just get used to this. It's like a massive thunder, you know. Massive peal of thunder. Okay, the thunder's already happened. Don't say, hey, I wonder how the next thunder's going to sound. No, just say, how do I feel? Having just experienced this thunder like that. Wow. That was thunderous. You see sometimes boxers, they get hit with a blow and it's like they're virtually knocked out and they say, oh, come on, hit me again. That didn't hurt me. Come on. Like that. It's overcompensation, you know. You get staggered. You say, wow, I'm staggered. Go against the ropes. There's no separation at all between arising, subsiding, not arising. Sustaining and not arising, sustaining, not arising. So whenever you're able to stagger your mind in some way like this, that's tremendous progress. So that don't get greedy. Don't get greedy. That's just say, okay, let's get used to this. Don't say, come on, hit me with another something stronger. That wasn't enough. No, it was like very much enough. Don't underestimate the severity of the continuity problem. It will pretend, when it's staggered, it'll pretend, oh, that wasn't much, come on, hit me again, to try to avoid experiencing this, you know. So I just need to, like, check everything out. Here, because this is a fundamental truth. And so we want to just make sure everything feels familiar and looks familiar. Just let the mind be quiet. Don't let the mind work on it. Don't let the intellect work on it. Just let familiarity work on it. So again, honesty is the best policy. Don't try to show off and prove to other people what a great meditator you are. When you feel this has just really been hit hard by something, that right there, you just say, wow, okay, I'm going to give this some time to get used to this. That's enough. Whereas the ego will try to drive people to say, oh, no, I got to keep meditating. I keep meditating. Just No. Be honest. Be honest with yourself. Be aware of your reaction. And I was aware that this one just hit like a massive peal of thunder and just a thunderous reverberation. Obviously, this is something supremely important. Be honest. Don't try to impress anyone. Either way. highlights the importance of sitting quietly. Because this is so staggering that I don't really feel like moving. And when one is willing to sit still without getting up, then these type of recognitions take place because you feel comfortable. So I can handle this. So you see how important it is, even on an ideal day like this in the Bay Area, how bringing spiritual intensity to stagger the mind, how that gives tremendous depth to the day, whereas not doing that keeps everything shallow and flat. So, this recognition really has legs to it, and I can feel it's shocking, you know, all systems, staggering all systems, all belief. The belief system has just been staggered by this. There's no separation at all. Between appearance and non-appearance, there's none. It's all one seamless, non-separate happening, spontaneity. You see, spontaneity in the now has as much to do with what doesn't appear as what does appear. As much to do with what arises as it does with what subsides. As much to do with what is sustained as what is not sustained. Sustaining an appearance and sustaining a non-appearance. The same. So the mind is so staggered, it's hard to talk at this point. That's why it's very important to have some place where no one will interrupt you. Hopefully. Traditionally, there have been places like this, for instance, a chapel or something. You go to church or chapel, you're in there, and nobody's supposed to come up and talk to you or ask you questions or bother you. You can feel comfortable being there. Nobody's going to will approach you. So you can just be quiet and don't have to talk. It's okay to have a recognition that staggers the mind to the point where you don't even feel like talking, which is the case here. This is such a tidal change that really, what can one say? Seeing there's no separation at all. Seeing whatever is tidal change just is deeper than that. Suddenly the tide just suddenly went really low. Just so much is revealed, you're just like, oh. You struck almost speechless. Don't bother evaluating. Just get used to it. Don't try to think, well, how will this be tomorrow? How will I feel? No. Just let it be. Just let it be. Just get used to it. Just let it be. Get used to it. So this is not like some sort of silent meditation. I'm just getting used to this, you know, being staggered here. I'm feeling that the shock, the staggeredness of this. I'm just getting used to it, just kind of just sitting here, just getting used to it, that's all. just so the next time it will be easier. So the time you put in now simply makes the next time easier. The staggering part, partly, is that my mind was able to see this. So the mind is a stagger, said, wow, I just took a look at this and I saw it. That means it's there, it's there to be seen. Maybe I'll see it again. What if I look there again? So the mind's like, oh my gosh. Reminded of like hiking Yosemite up to this big waterfall when they used to have waterfalls there. I don't think there's much waterfalls last year. It's been a while. But we went one year, it was like super rainy and it was tremendous. What was it, Bridalville Falls or something, one of the big falls. And from a distance you see through the trees, you see something, you hear some distant thundering, you say, wow, what's that? Wow. And then you hike as you go along the trail, and as you're hiking through the trees, it shifts and changes, and you glimpse more and more as you're going through the trees of this, some incredible cataract, you know, some incredible waterfall, what it was going, and every time you see it, you just get a little closer, it's just, wow, what am I going towards here, this is amazing, and then you finally, you know, you get there, and then you just see the whole thing, and it's power, you know, it's just incredible. Volume of water, and it's just like, oh my gosh. But you gradually got used to it as you're hiking towards it. So it's like that. The spiritual path is like hiking towards a massive waterfall. Positive way, beautiful, something's just really beautiful. Oh, wow. You get closer and closer, glimpses, 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 glimpses. And sometimes you just want to stop and just rest a little bit. And you just say, wow. You can hear the thundering, the spray, you feel the air, feel spray, say, wow, I know I'm really close to something stupendous here. So let me just catch my breath and let my nerves settle here. So there's no, it's smart, it's real super smart to take a little rest and don't quit. Just say, let me lean up against the tree here just for a moment. Let me just get used to where I am right now. I see the mist going through the trees. I hear the roaring. I catch a glimpse through the trees. I can feel the vibration of the air and everything. I say, okay, I'm close. I'm really close to the, you know, the center of this. This is the super smart way to go about it. Then when you do that for a little while, then you feel calm. You feel calm, and then you can go forward. And eventually you get there, you'll be calm. You'll be calm. You won't be all agitated and frightened and threatened and everything. Be calm, say, okay, now I'm here. Just get used to that. And if it's too much, you just back off. Let me back down the trail a little bit here and just rest for a little while. Now, those who are not going towards the waterfall, they may stay there, they may be wandering around in the opposite direction. They're hiking real fast, and they say, look how much progress I'm making. I don't need to slow down. And why are they slowing down like that? That's nonsense. Because they're not going towards the waterfall. They're avoiding it. So if you're really going towards the waterfall, you're going to feel it. You're going to know. Honestly, you're going to know, wow, I'm making progress. I'm getting close. This is intense, very intense. And those others who are wandering off through the forest somewhere else, who think they're going towards it, now we're just taking a very circuitous route here. We're going over to the meadow over here. We're wandering over here, picnicking here, you know. They don't feel the intensity. So, of course, they can seem to be saying, look, they say, look, I can meditate for 10 hours straight, and no problem, I'm some super meditator. Yeah, but they're not going towards the waterfall, right? It's just an athletic event for them. Anyone can do that. Just let me see if I can just sit here for as long as possible. What we're doing is we're actually going towards this waterfall, getting real close, feeling the intensity, and then being and then sitting quietly and just catching our breath. So this just flipped the script incredibly, or amazingly. It is credible, amazingly. A tremendous slip of the script. So my belief system has been staggered. Keep the hands away. No scratching. So remember, real meditation is not just enjoying nature, like sitting by a lake and just enjoying the quiet of nature or something. That's now. It's way beyond that. You can realize this sitting in your room. In fact, it may be easier to do so. This is like landing a knockout punch on the false belief system. Well, it's certainly a staggering blow. So we might be saying, well, I don't know what to believe now. Well, who says we need to believe anything? Belief entails believing we can change reality. Reality doesn't need to believe anything. Reality doesn't need to believe that reality can't be changed. So to say, well, I don't know what to believe is a positive statement. So I don't need belief. need to believe. I don't know what to believe. I've never known what to believe. I don't exist. I've never existed. I don't know what to believe. I've never known what to believe. Wow. So, the purpose of these videos is to bring this intensity, the staggering the mind. It's very difficult to find this in the world, which is why I'm doing these videos, is try to help out. If you just allow yourself to drift in the culture of this world, you're never going to get to this. No way. I don't know what to believe. Believe? I've never known what to believe. I have never known what to believe. Drill one tooth at a time. You go to the dentist, you know, you get one done and let you rest a little bit and say, okay, let's get this other one. don't try to drill them all at one time. It's too much. And yet we must keep it going. I've never known what to believe. I never will know what to believe. I've never existed. I never will exist. Don't know what to believe. I've never known what to believe. I never will know what to believe. There's nothing to believe. There's nothing to believe. So hang in there. We know that the dust settles on this, so don't panic. There's nothing to believe. Nothing exists. And there's nothing to believe. nothing exists and there's nothing to believe. Wow. I just felt some sort of release here. And it's like, wow. Got through it somehow. This is great. All right, it was really great. Very intense. Nothing has ever happened. Nothing exists. Nothing exists. There's nothing to believe. Nothing has ever happened. There's no teaching. There's no teacher. There's no student. And I am not a body. I am free. I am spirit as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am spirit as God created me. Okay, so the day has already taken on awesome significance. Wow. And we'll see if we can keep the momentum going here. I feel a bit like Gumby here, just like that's how hard it hit. Nothing to believe in. Absolutely nothing to believe in. Nothing to exist. There's absolutely no existence whatsoever. There's no nothing to believe in whatsoever. There's no teaching whatsoever. There's no teacher whatsoever. There's no student whatsoever. No existence. No belief. No existence, no belief. No existence, no belief. No existence, no belief. So again, what we're doing is we're moving our comfort zone. That's all. Moving our comfort zone. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.